is Wednesday, the 29th of April. Today's Mass is offered for the repose of the soul of Pauline Becker. And the saint we are honoring today is Saint Catherine of Siena, Virgin, Doctor. Catherine was born in Siena in 1347 and was the 23rd child of Jacopo and Lapa Benicasa. She was an intelligent, cheerful, and religious young lady. At the age of 18, she entered the Dominican Third Order, spending the following 3 years in solitude, long years in prayer and in penance. Gradually, she attracted followers among priests, religious, and laity, whom she encouraged and guided in the spiritual life. Catherine also took an active interest in public affairs of the church. She was instrumental in having Pope Gregory XI return to Rome from Avignon. She supported his successor in Rome, Urban VI, against the Avignon faction. Not very robust in health at any time, she suffered a stroke 8 days before her death, which occurred on April 29, 1380, at the age of 33. In chapter 167 of her dialogues, we read, "Eternal God, eternal Trinity, you have made the blood of Christ so precious through his sharing in your divine nature. You are a mystery as deep as the sea. The more I search, the more I find. And the more I find, the more I search for you. But I can never be satisfied. What I receive will ever leave me desiring more." Dialogue, second reading, Liturgy of the Hours. Throughout her life, Catherine had mystical experiences, the first at age 6. These guided her life choices. She was also blessed with the stigmata. Her mystical teaching is found in the dialogues, in her letters, and in some 24 prayers. Central to her theology is the redeeming Christ on the cross and his blood which is poured out mercifully for all people. All of her writings reveal the mystic's hunger for God. "When you fill my soul, I have an even greater hunger, and I grow more famished for your light. I desire above all to see you, the true light, as you really are." Catherine longed to surrender herself completely to God. "I have tasted and seen the depth of your mystery and the beauty of your creation with the light of my understanding. I have clothed myself with your likeness and have seen what I shall be. Eternal Father, you have given me a share in your power and the wisdom that Christ claims as his own. And your Holy Spirit has given me the desire to love you." Saint Catherine had difficulty with critics and slanderers, even to the point where she had to defend herself before a Dominican general chapter. It is difficult to appreciate Saint Catherine of Siena in so few minutes, but what Aloy Maria Haas has written is a beginning. Mystical rapture in God always gave Catherine great certitude for quick action. The image of knightly battle inspired her, and she fought against ecclesiastical decadence through criticism, instruction, and preaching about poverty and obedience, the necessity of an uncompromising knowledge of self and of God, prudence, and the renunciation of self-love and egoism. In sum, it was a unique attempt to unite action and contemplation in a life dedicated to the good of the church. Catherine's life was consumed by and offered up for the church. The church was her guarantor of the redeeming blood of Christ, the nursing mother of salvation. Her mysticism received from this a strong emphasis on the history and community of salvation. The opening prayer of the Mass sums up her life succinctly. Father, in meditating on the suffering of your Son and in serving your church, St. Catherine was filled with the fervor of your love. The antiphon at the Magnificat in evening prayer adds, always and everywhere, Catherine sought and found God. Through the strength of her love, she entered into union with him. St. Catherine of Siena was canonized in 1461. She was declared a doctor of the church in 1970 by Pope Paul VI.
Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
God in his goodness call us to follow him. Let us pause for a moment to reflect the times in our lives where we have not faithfully, joyfully followed God. For these times, let us ask the Lord for his pardon and mercy. Lord Jesus, you are sent to heal the contrite. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ Jesus, you call us to follow you. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you are the example of holiness. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Let us pray. O God, who set St. Catherine of Siena on fire with divine love, in her contemplation of the Lord's passion and her service of God's church, grant through her intercession that your people participating in the mystery of Christ may ever exult in the revelation of his glory, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen. A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. There broke out a severe persecution of the church in Jerusalem, and all were scattered throughout the countryside of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. Devout men buried Stephen and made a loud lament over him. Saul, meanwhile, was trying to destroy the church, entering house after house and dragging out men and women. He handed them over for imprisonment. Now those who had scattered went about preaching the word. Thus, Philip went down to the city of Samaria and proclaimed the Christ to them. With one accord, the crowds paid attention to what was said by Philip, when they heard it and saw the signs he was doing. For unclean spirits, crying out in a loud voice, came out of many possessed people. And many paralyzed and crippled people were cured. There was great joy in that city. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The responsorial psalm. Let all the earth cry out to God with joy.
Let all the earth cry out to God with joy.
Shout joyfully to God, all the earth. Sing praise to the glory of his name. Proclaim his glorious praise. Say to God, how tremendous are your deeds.
Let all the earth cry out to God with joy.
Let all on earth worship and sing praise to you. Sing praise to your name. Come and see the works of God, his tremendous deeds among the children of Adam.
Let all the earth cry out to God with joy.
He has changed the sea into dry land. Through the river they passed on foot. Therefore, let us rejoice in him. He rules by his might forever.
Let all the earth cry out to God with joy. Alleluia. Alleluia. eternal life, and I shall raise him on the last day, says the Lord.
Alleluia! Alleluia! Alleluia!
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said to the crowds, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never hunger. Whoever believes in me will never thirst. But I told you that although you have seen me, you do not believe. Everything that the Father gives me will come to me, and I will not reject anyone who comes to me. Because I came down from heaven, not to do my own will, but the will of the one who sent me. And this is the will of the one who sent me, that I should not lose anything of what he gave me, but that I should raise it on the last day. For this is the will of my Father, that everyone who sees the Son and believes in him may have eternal life, and I shall raise him on the last day. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
It wasn't that long ago, months ago, in fact, for that matter, that most of us have never heard of coronavirus. Most of us have never heard of shelter in place or social distance. Cities were thriving, people were commuting, enjoying life, people were eating out, traveling, doing the normal things. And it wasn't that long ago that we have never heard of Wuhan in China. And now, of course, it's a common language thing that all of us have heard about it. And now, as we know it, has changed quite a difference. That everything is slower now. Every of us are homebound pretty much. Don't go out anymore. Life has greatly changed. And it wasn't that long ago, 2,000 years ago, a great event that no one heard much about. In fact, the greatest event in the history of the human of civilization, of the world, that no one saw or experienced it, was the resurrection of Christ. That no one was there even to see it, witness it. The greatest miracle ever, that a man, a God, rose from the dead. And this great event changed our life forever. Why does it change our life forever? Why does it? Aggie? Why does it change our life forever? The resurrection of Christ, why does that make a difference to our life?
Well, he's become part of our life. We share him. He's in our heart all the time. And
doesn't your kids also part of your life? That's a great event. But what's the difference between Jesus' resurrection, part of your life, versus your children and the people in your life?
Well, Jesus' resurrection is preparing me for life to come, for heaven.
Only in the future?
And the present.
In what way the present? What way does it impact the present now? Ice? In what way does it affect your life now, the resurrection of Christ? Think about it in today's scripture. What does it say, the gospel? Those who come to me will never thirst, will never hunger or thirst anymore. Why are they never thirst and hunger anymore? Does that mean that you're not ever hungry anymore? You're not going to eat anymore?
No, we just have that fullness of the Lord, the grace from him to keep on pursuing or doing what we need to do.
Yes, but also remember, what is the greatest longing of the human heart? The desire that whether
to be loved. And to love.
Yes, to love and to be loved. But you know the downside of love and to be loved, you know what that is? When you love someone very much and they love you very much, what is always the one thing that's always hanging over your head?
Expectations.
Yes, that you're always afraid that you'll lose them someday, right? Isn't that the greatest fear? Because there's an old saying in the Vietnamese culture, you know, to know love is to know suffering. There's always behind it, because the more you love, the more scared. Because you know the day is going to come when you lose a person. You know, you don't know what you're going to do with yourself. It's like, someday I lose my wife, my kids, if these things happen, I don't know, what am I going to do? My life is going to be so, my heart is going to be literally, feels like it's going to be ripped out. It's going to leave a hole, a huge hole in my chest. Mm-hmm. I'm going to feel so empty. What am I going to do? And Jesus' resurrection, how does that impact that love? Because it would, his eternal life promises that that love, even in death, can it ever be cut off, severed? No, it can't. Even as the scripture reminds us, nothing can ever separate you from love of God or even the people you love in your life. Because guess what? When you love them and you have Christ in your life with them, we will see them again. That's the promise of Jesus Christ. I will never lose anyone who's entrusted to me. They will always be mine, and I will be them. And that's a beautiful, beautiful thing. And that's how I'm a little confused by the world that we live in. Because oftentimes, every year in September, yeah, roughly in September, what is the great event that many people are truly excited about? For every year, there's certain things that people are excited at a certain time of year. Christmas, of course, is exciting because, for many people,
gifts.
And Thanksgiving.
Eating.
Yes, the turkey. Excited about that. And of course, for the Mac and Apple fan out there, what's great about September? New iPhone comes out, right?
Oh, okay.
And of course, Black Friday, people are excited because?
Shopping,
yes. Great deals, or they hope they have great deals on a few bargain items that are going to people fight over. And sometimes I kind of wonder myself, why do people get that excited about a new TV show or movie? Because the last time I checked, Walmart, Fred Meyer, and these great sales, does it promise eternal life?
No.
No, it doesn't, does it? A new iPhone, no matter how wonderful a product is, it'll be a has-been by next year. You're like, oh, okay, big deal. New 12 is going to be exciting, but wait until next year after that, you know? There'll be another one. And so on, and so on, and so on. But Christ's love never grow old. Like our love with one another never grow old. If you really experience love, true meaning of love, you experience what true joy is, that nothing can replace it. It can't be bought. It can't be rented. Well, some people say it can, but that's a different story. We don't need to go there. But I mean, true love is a real richness in life. It gives true meaning. And that's the love that Jesus offered each and every one of us. But what does it take to accept that love? If God's love is really that great, how come not everyone is that excited about it? You know, if it's freely given so much, why isn't everyone so excited?
You have to want it.
You have to want it. Anything else? Doesn't people already want it? Isn't that already understood?
People nowadays want instant gratification.
Yes, instant gratification, but also perhaps their hearts or mind are close to it. Sometimes, like the story about the prodigal son, he had to lose everything to see how deep the father's love is. He had to, before his life was pretty good, but he didn't realize how good it was until he lost everything. And the father, even though he didn't deserve it, the father welcomed him home and loved him even though he didn't deserve it. Mm-hmm. And that's the love that the father gives each and every one of us. And that's the love I see that is present in the lives of the saints. Saint Catherine of Siena today, we hear. I mean, amazing woman. And I was thinking of today, as you are reading about her life story, 3 years in solitude when she was entering her religious life. I thought to myself, boy, she really has it on us. You know, a couple of months and we're most of us already dying. But Catherine of Siena, 3 years of solitude. And I wonder if those 3 years really shaped her love for Christ. Because for 3 years, she's open to the Lord, and nothing was important to her except God. Mm-hmm. 3 years, she traveled the Lord. That her life was focused on the Lord. And in that 3 years, she was enriched and filled with the God's love. And that's what allowed her to become a saint and transform her life, which later on allowed her to transform the world, to be a great witness to each and every one of us. And we too, during this time, is also a great opportunity for us to be transformed by the love of Christ. If we're open to Him, hear Him, allow Him, and listen to Him to transform that, to allow Him to transform our hearts. And so today, my brothers and sisters, I just invite you to open your minds and your heart to the Lord, that in doing so may receive the abundance of His love in your life and be transformed by it, to be in His image and to be saints for one another. Trusting in God's love and mercy, let us turn to Him now for all our needs and all the needs of the world. For Pope Francis, for Alexander, our bishop, and all our priests, bishops, and deacons, may God's grace be upon them to help them always to be true shepherds in guiding their people to follow Christ. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us also pray for ourselves in each and every day, when we put our trust and our faith in Jesus, that in doing so, may Jesus transform us and lead us to do His will. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us also pray that each and every one of us may never hunger and thirst for anything else, because we have love of Christ in our hearts. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us also pray for all the prayers that concern the words that lie deep within our hearts. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us also pray for all our brothers and sisters who have gone before us, trusting and believing God's love and mercy. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Loving, compassionate Father, accept the prayers of Your family gathered here. Help each and every one of us, O Lord, to turn to You, that in doing so, may we experience Your love and Your mercy. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Blessed are You, Lord God of all creation, for through Your goodness we have received the wine we offer You, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become our spiritual drink.
Blessed be God forever.
Pray, dearly beloved, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of His name, for our good and for the good of all His holy church.
Accept, O Lord, the saving sacrifice we offer in commemoration of Saint Catherine, so that instructed by her teaching, we may give ever more fervent thanks to You, the one true God, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give You thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, for in the saints who consecrate themselves to Christ, for the sake of the kingdom, it is right to celebrate the wonders of Your providence, by which You call human nature back to its original holiness, and to bring it to experience on this earth the gifts You promised in the new world to come. And so of all the angels and saints we praise You, as if our end we acclaim. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice and, once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church. Spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity. Together with Francis, our Pope, and Alexander, our Bishop, and all the clergy, remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, and with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heir to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom and the power and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance of your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other a sign of peace. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world.
Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you
take away the sins of the world. Grant us peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. If we walk in the light, as God is in the light, then we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of his Son, Jesus Christ, cleanses us from all sin. Alleluia.
Let us pray. May the heavenly table at which we have been fed, O Lord, confer eternal life upon us, and even in this world, it nourishes the life of St. Catherine through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May the Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Mass is ended. Go in peace, love, and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Saint Michael, the Archangel, defend us in battle.
Be our protection against the
wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke and we humbly pray.
And do thou,
O Prince of the Heavenly Hosts, by the power of God, cast into hell Satan
and all evil spirits, who prowl about the world seeking the ruin of souls.
Amen.